So let's start off the video with a question. What are your expectations for the Lakers this upcoming season, assuming everyone's healthy? Go ahead and leave your thoughts in the comment section down below. I'm gonna be reading them, don't worry. Now, it's already been a busy start for the Los Angeles Lakers this offseason, and they started it off with a bang, trading for Russell Westbrook on draft night. If you haven't seen that already, I made a video talking about what I thought about that trade in my last video. But as expected, since that trade, the Lakers have been trying their best to get as much talent as they can with the limited cap space that they have. And thank God they've signed nothing but shooters, bigs, and like a couple additional playmakers. To give y'all a little bit more context on what the Lakers did in free agency, at least as of the recording of this video, the Lakers managed to sign Carmelo Anthony, Kendrick Nunn, Trevor Ariza, Wayne Ellington, Malik Monk, Dwight Howard, Kent Bazemore, and re-signed Talen Horton Tucker as well. Just from the amount of signings the Lakers made, Twitter was already going crazy. But the biggest conversation has been regarding super teams and whether or not this Los Angeles Lakers squad qualifies as a super team. Now, these conversations already have been going around since the Lakers traded for Russell Westbrook a couple of days ago, and they've only intensified after the first day of free agency. And because of these conversations, I think it's time for us to truly talk about exactly what qualifies as a super team and why, to me, this Los Angeles Lakers squad is indeed a super team. Now, when you ask the question, what is the definition of a super team? There are many answers that people throw out there. Some people say it's three all-star caliber players on the same team, but especially in 2021, that's a really poor definition that can be applied to like literally 10 plus teams in the league. According to Wikipedia, a super team is a franchise whose roster typically has three or more Hall of Fame caliber players that are in their prime. Other people say it's two top 10 players in the league, playing alongside another top 30 player in the league. Some people say it's the number of All-NBA caliber players on a team. There are a lot of answers to this question that have led to a lot of ambiguity when it comes to defining what an NBA super team is. But in this video, I want to pose you guys my definition of what a super team is. And it all revolves around the word expectation. Expectation. Spell it out with me. Expectations. Expectations. To me, the definition of a super team is not enclosed by the talent on a given team. It is simply around the expectations of a team. To be more specific, to me, a super team is a team where the expectations are championship or bust. It's as simple as that. So before I elaborate on my definition, let's just bring up a couple teams that undoubtedly are super teams. At least if you have common sense, you know, they're undoubtedly super teams. Let's just talk about the post-2000s for now, so at least a decent amount of people that are watching this video can, you know, actually kind of recall what the landscape in the NBA was at that time and, you know, possibly have watched it. Number one, the 2008 Boston Celtics. Number two, the Big Three Miami Heat. And number three, the 2017 Golden State Warriors. Those three teams to me are undoubtedly super teams. And I feel like to a majority of people, regardless of how they classify what a super team is to them, those teams typically do qualify and are the standard of what a super team is. And what made those specific teams super teams to me really wasn't just the talent on the team. It was this sense of a team being assembled that by far should be the favorites to win the championship. And anything less than that is a failure. In other words, these are teams that had seasons where the expectations on them was championship or bust. Now, I can already hear the arguments, man. So let's address a lot of them, actually. Let's address a lot of them.
What about the 1980s, B-Souls, when the Lakers and the Celtics both had stacked squads? There wasn't really a year where either of them were extremely favored to win a championship because the other team existed.
And I would say, honestly, you're right on that. I never said there can only be one super team in the league. Once those teams got a year or two under their belts, both the Lakers and the Celtics had expectations of winning a championship, and anything short of honestly losing to each other in the finals was a disappointment. Therefore, to me, both of those teams would still be super teams. Let me just add real quick, I think the Bad Boy Pistons in the late 1980s were also a super team. The same would go for many of those 1960s Boston Celtics teams.
Now, what about the 1990s Chicago Bulls, B-Souls? Many of those years, the Bulls were favored to win a championship and had expectations of championship or bust. And that means That means they were a super team, right? MJ played on a super team, right?
The first championship run, I don't think they were a super team. If you looked at the preseason odds for the 1991 season, the Pistons, the Lakers, and the Spurs were more favored to win a championship than the Chicago Bulls. And leading up to the playoffs, a lot of people want to ignore this fact, but there was a lot of doubt with Michael Jordan's ability to lead a team to a championship. But ever since then, every single year Jordan was available going into the season, the Bulls were favored to win a championship, had nothing but championship expectations, with anything less than winning a championship being a disappointment. So to me, those teams were super teams. And if I happen to have said they weren't in the past, then I am here to correct that. Michael Jordan did play on some super teams.
Now, what about the early 2000s Lakers, B-Souls? Is Shaq, Kobe, and a bunch of quality starters enough to call you a super team?
Their first championship in 2000, I don't believe they were a super team, especially since Kobe wasn't even a bona fide superstar yet. But after that year, up until Shaq left, I would say they were a super team. However, the Spurs are interesting because, as we know, throughout the 2000s and early 2010s, the San Antonio Spurs were a 50-win team every single year and were near, if not at the top of the Western Conference. But honestly, as good as they were, they were never really a super team to me. Yes, there were years where they were favored to win the championship. More specifically, the time between Shaq and Kobe broke up and the forming of the Big Three Celtics in 2008. But there was never really a year where if the Spurs lost, it just seemed like unfathomable or like a really big upset. In the mid-2000s, if the Suns happened to beat the Spurs, if the Mavs happened to beat the Spurs, if the Pistons or the Heat happened to beat the Spurs in the finals, it wasn't really like this unfathomable thing to see.
Now, what about the Warriors pre-KD?
Now, that's been up for a lot of debate, but I truly don't think they were a super team their first championship year. Number one, no one expected Steph Curry to win MVP and that team to be as good as they were. Imagine going into that season and saying the Golden State Warriors were going to win 67 games and Steph Curry was going to win MVP. Like, you would have looked stupid, I ain't gonna lie. Let alone actually win the championship. 2016, however, I think is the most highly debatable one. Because I think a lot of people have forgotten that going into the 2015 season, the only team that was in super team conversations was actually the Cleveland Cavaliers. After LeBron came home and teamed up with Kyrie Irving and Kevin Love, it was actually the Cleveland Cavaliers that were favored to win the championship going into that season. And after seeing what the Cavs could do without Kyrie and K-Love in the finals, which was pushing the Golden State Warriors to 6 games, going into the 2016 season, it was the Cavs that were once again favored to win the championship. However, by the time the playoffs rolled around, after the season Curry had, after the Warriors won 73 games, going into the playoffs, anything short of a championship for the Golden State Warriors was considered a disappointment. So honestly, yes, to me, the 2016 Golden State Warriors, by the end of the season, were a super team. The 2017 Cleveland Cavaliers might be the most interesting case when it comes to defining a super team, because they had expectations of making it to the finals, with anything less being a massive disappointment. And I don't know about y'all, but I remember after Christmas Day when Kyrie hit that shot over Klay Thompson, yeah, motherfuckers like Nick Wright saying the Cavs had the Warriors number despite the roster that they had. And honestly, if we're keeping it a buck, links in the description, the finals was way closer than people want to make it seem. I think a big part of a lot of those narratives was just people really being highly delusional with the gap between the Warriors and the Cavs after they added KD, because of LeBron being LeBron and coming back from 3-1 against all odds. So why couldn't he do it again? There was a lot of that. So I would say, honestly, the Cavs are like on the line of being a super team, like right on the line. Another interesting question would be the 2020 Lakers and the 2020 Clippers. Look, if you guys follow me on Twitter, you guys know that I've expressed my thoughts on the Clippers before, and how even before this video, I already thought they had a bigger case of being a super team than what many people want to admit. It's the Lakers, however, where my stance has been shaky, because up until this video, I was on the quest to find the definition for what a super team is. However, let's just look back a little bit, because when those two teams formed, and with everyone knowing that KD wasn't going to be on the Nets because of his Achilles injury, the Clippers and the Lakers, talent-wise, were on a tier of their own, were the only two teams in the league that had championship or bust expectations, and continued to have those expectations leading up to the playoffs. everyone was hyping up the Battle of LA for a reason. So yes, if I said anything otherwise in the past, I would like to correct them and go on record and say that the 2020 Lakers and the 2020 Clippers were in fact a super team. However, I will say after the 2019-2020 season, expectations did change a lot, where the Clippers just didn't have the same championship expectations because of how bad they choked in the playoffs. However, it's the Lakers. It's the Lakers. After winning the championship, were viewed as a team that got even better after an offseason signing Marc Gasol, Dennis Schroeder, and Montrezl Harrell. So much so that even after the Nets' big three formed in Brooklyn, the Lakers were still favored to win the championship, assuming they were healthy. And speaking of the Nets, I know a lot of people are gonna bring up,
B-Souls, didn't you say the Nets weren't a super team after they got Harden?
Yes, I did. Because by the time the trade happened, a majority of people still had the Lakers as the favorites to win the championship. But also, I'm not gonna lie, I was just more so wrong on the take. I mean, I can be wrong, like I'm just here to spark discussions. But also, as the season went on and the Nets were just balling the fuck out, a lot of the people that were saying the Lakers could win the championship healthy switched over and said that the Nets were gonna beat the Lakers if the Nets were fully healthy. And it became very clear that this Nets team, when fully healthy, were the favorites to win the championship, and it was a championship or bust season. However, they just weren't healthy. So yes, the Nets were and still are a super team.
But B-Souls, didn't you just say in your last video that the Lakers got worse with Russell Westbrook? How did they get worse and simultaneously become a super team?
This whole video, I've been talking about how my definition is purely based off of expectations. I even spelled it out for you guys. That doesn't mean you can't have high expectations that in reality shouldn't have been as high as they were. That's why failed super teams are a thing. The 2004 Lakers had championship or bust expectations. After signing Carmelo and Gary Payton, who were still all-star caliber players the season prior, on a team with Shaq and Kobe with the best coach in the league. By all sense of the word, they were a super team. But the reality was the fit wasn't as perfect as it seemed on paper, and they had players that were susceptible to injury, whether that be due to their recent track record or, you know, being 40 years old. Karl. And all I'm saying is this 2021 Lakers squad, like the 2004 Lakers, have a personnel whose fit is highly questionable. And not only do they have an injury-prone superstar in Anthony Davis, LeBron James, who is their leader, is going to be 37 years old and has been significantly injured in two of the last three NBA seasons. And Russell Westbrook himself has been injured in the last two postseasons. Yet despite that, they are a team who have expectations where anything else but winning a championship or losing to a team with equal expectations in the Brooklyn Nets is considered a failure. And I ask y'all on Twitter, is this season a championship or bust season for the Los Angeles Lakers? 84% yes on that question. I also asked you guys on my community post and got virtually the same results with 3 times the sample size. And by that account, I will go on record and say that the 2021 Los Angeles Lakers are indeed a super team, and anything beyond this point is simply a super team flopping or losing to a team again with equal expectations in the Brooklyn Nets. Also, for future reference, I do want to document the narratives that are going around as of the making of this video. Once again, whether or not they're favored to win the championship, the Los Angeles Lakers do have championship expectations, and anything aside from it is considered a failure, aside from losing to the Nets essentially. I also want to document the credit that's been given to LeBron for these signings. Despite people like myself doubting the fit of Russell Westbrook on the team, there has been this strong, very strong narrative that we should just trust LeBron, and he knows more about the game than we do. I want to document that. Let's also document the supposed meeting that Russell Westbrook and LeBron James had about setting their egos aside in order to win a championship. Let's just save this for future reference in the case, the off chance that narrative shift about how, you know, LeBron James has no help and how poorly this roster is constructed. Let's just, for future reference, document how much input LeBron supposedly has on how this Lakers team is constructed. But that's going to be all for this video, man. Hit that sub button if you enjoyed this video. But with that being said, I'm out. Peace.